नमस्ते, वेलकम टू बीटीयू ई शिक्षण प्रोग्राम। आई डॉक्टर दक्षायणी आर पाटिल, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर बीएमएस कॉलेज ऑफ आर्किटेक्चर बेंगलुरु, वेलकम यू ऑल वंस अगेन टू जॉइन मी फॉर दिस कोर्स बिल्डिंग सर्विसेज 3, 18 ईआरसी 6-3 फॉर स्पीआर 6 सेमेस्टर, करंट सेशन ऑफ 2021। एंड दिस इज एन इनिशिएटिव बाय विश्वेश्वरैया टेक्नोलॉजिकल यूनिवर्सिटी बेलगावी under the e-shikshana program by the e-learning center. So I am handling modules 1 and 2 currently we are with the module 2 air conditioning systems, section number 3 where we have completed the various types of air conditioning systems, the requirements as with respect to the architectural design, etc. So we are doing basics of duct sizing and routing. We did one lecture session before this on the basics of understanding of air distribution system. So we will move ahead today. This is the overview of the references. So lecture number 10 and the topic is continuation of air distribution system ADS and duct design. So the objective of this lecture would be to understand the types of ADS, ducts, and the concept of pressure drop, because it is one of the reasons when the efficiency of duct in carrying the expected conditioned air to the space gets reduced. So we will see what are the reasons for the pressure drop, then designing the duct layout and the methods adopted to design ducts, various characteristics of a good ducting network in HVAC system, and duct elbows, the junctions where two ducts meet or when a duct has to make a turn to the next point. Air handling unit, just a quick glimpse or a revising what an AHU is. We have done an elaborate section lecture on this. So air handling unit is the interface between the AC plant room, which has the compressor condenser, and the space that has to be conditioned, where the air has to be cooled or treated as we require. So air handling unit, which comprises of the fan, the cooling coil or the evaporator, air filters, bypass dampers. So all these are assembled in a compact casing with a drive motor for the fan mounted on the casing. These are also known as air handling unit AHU. They are mostly field assembled. That is, you come to the site and get the AHU unit or the room ready. But sometimes we also have the provision for factory fabricated and assembled. And they are available in different sizes and capacities as per our HVAC requirement and the overall scheme of things. The factory assembled ones, which are called as fan coil units, are used for smaller capacities. They come the ton of refrigeration is for smaller capacities, whereas when you have larger building areas that have to be conditioned, the AHU will be housed in the machinery is quite imposing, so it needs a dedicated room called as AHU room, air handling unit room. So now this AHU is the interface between the space to be conditioned and the plant room per se. So we have to design this or locate it in a very logical manner, and on every floor the AHU has to be provided. Whereas a plant room is a single entity either on the ground floor or detached from the building, so that will house a compressor condenser. And AHU will house the evaporator coil or the cooling coil, and it is a must whenever a space has to be cooled, it is adjunct to it. Now, ducts will come in different shapes, square, circular, rectangular. We normally decide all this based on the space that is available to us. There are times when we probably have done the conceptual drawing without keeping HVAC, future HVAC planning in mind, and we end up giving 3 meters ceiling, floor ceiling height, which is not really sufficient, because in that we have to have the beam drop 250, 300, up to 400, and then comes a fall ceiling, and the duct has to sit below the beam. So then square or circular might be a little tough task to accommodate. Then we go in for designed rectangular ducts, especially sized and fabricated. So keeping this in mind is very crucial. So 3 meters wouldn't be an ideal height for providing fall ceiling and embedding the services within the fall ceiling space, which is called as the plenum space. Now the left one is the rectangular duct, then we have the circular duct, then also we have the flexible hose ducts. So these are used where it has to, the duct has to maneuver a very tricky turning kind of a journey. So frequent turns or sneak into difficult spaces where straight ducts as these, which consume more space, is not possible. So flexible hose is made up of high strength steel wires wrapped with aluminium foil composite members. And to the right, the circular duct ends with a diffuser, that is a terminal component. And this is an exposed duct which is hung, or you will see the lights there. So basically speaking, the fall ceiling space or the plenum space becomes a host for several services. The lights, the AC terminal diffusers, or the grills to take in the return air and supply the cooled air. Then we have smoke detectors, heat detectors as the time as it requires. Then we have the sprinklers embedded for fire protection. So all these has to be thought of in a better envisaged fall ceiling plan. Then when the rectangular duct is making a turn, you have a smooth curve bend that you see. Such a bend is called as elbow. It is similar to the elbow of the hand where you turn. So it's called duct elbow. As for the materials for the duct goes, we use galvanized steel, aluminum, fiberglass. There are flexible ducts also, like we saw in the previous picture, right? So high strength steel wires wrapped with aluminum foil, composite membranes. So materials also will be decided based on the requirement, on the budget, on the efficiency expected, etc. Now let us take a look at the duct cross section, a typical one. We have square and circular ones here. The duct, the square one where my cursor is moving, is the actual metal duct cross section. Now there are, if you see, there is a fiber wrap around it, and there are spacers. There are strings which are hanging the duct from the ceiling. Now the question might be, why do we have the fiber wrap? Why is the spacer? Now there are two reasons. The first reason, let us look at. These ducts are carrying air through them, either from the space, return air to the AHU, or the cooled, clean, dehumidified air from the AHU to the room. So they are going to have the air movement through them. So this air movement is at a certain velocity. It is not a very slow velocity, it is quite substantial. That might create turbulence. So there will be wobbling or a shaking of the duct, and may lead to vibration, noise, etc. So to hold that in place, we need a mechanism. Then second reason is, where is the duct located? It is in the plenum space between the ceiling and the fall ceiling. Is this space air conditioned? No. So the duct which is carrying cool air is passing through a non-conditioned space. So the air there is hotter than the cool air. So it might end up that the heat moves from the hot air to the cool air which is passing through the duct. So this makes it essential that we insulate the duct properly. Hence, we have the fiber wrap around the duct, and to avoid again, and there is come to the section to the right bottom, the duct section, the fiber wrap, and there is an air gap between it which acts as a cushion and an insulation to the actual duct section. Spacers are to hold both the surfaces intact, avoiding any kind of movement, vibration, or so. So these are the two reasons why we have the duct with the fiber wrap around it, spacers, and the air gap. Is that clear? You can draw any one typical section and label them and explain the components clearly. So that is about duct cross sections and understanding how a duct is designed to adjust to the air velocity that is going through to counteract the vibration and the noise and insulate the duct. Now, ADS air distribution systems are classified based on two aspects. One is velocity of the air and the other one is the pressure. So we have low velocity and high velocity types. Normally, low velocity is adopted for comfort conditions, for comfort AC, that is providing comfortable indoors for people in terms of temperature, pressure, and air draft, cleanliness, etc. High velocity most often used for process AC or industrial AC, that is AC meant to cater to a certain activity of manufacturing or so. Based on pressure, we have low pressure, medium pressure, high pressure, and it is the values are given there. So normally low velocity, low and medium pressures are adopted for comfort AC, and that is what we are going to study in this section. With respect to duct design, the first aspect that has to be thought about is size of the duct. So normally the size of the duct should be such that it is accommodated within the available space under the ceiling. So now when we conceptualize a design and decide on the ceiling floor height, if we haven't thought about these aspects, then we end up with the standard 3 meter height, clearance height, but that 3 meter comes with a beam drop of 250, 300, 400 sometimes, and below that should be the fall ceiling. So it becomes tricky to provide a suitable duct size there because this plenum space, what we call, and the fall ceiling should accommodate other services also, lights, fire detectors, sprinklers, then the AC return grills, AC supply grills. Okay, and the duct size is normally dependent on the space available as a second factor. Then, when we design anything, there is a capital cost involved in the beginning, that is the initial investment made for the duct ordering, that is material fabrication, installation. And then we have the other end, that is post occupancy or post usage, the operating costs, the fan power consumption. So this will be the life cycle cost of the item that you are talking about, and how much energy does it consume, and so forth. So reaching a balance between the initial cost and the operating cost as a well in advance estimation is required. So we have to realize the estimation for initial cost, capital cost investment, and the operating cost. Pressure drop is a serious concern with when we encounter duct designs. The pressure of the air falls due to two factors. One is a frictional loss, because something moves on a surface, friction loss is encountered. Dynamic loss is due to the sudden changes of the direction of airflow, velocity and eddy sources. So let us read a paragraph from Professor Anant Narayan's book, Basic Refrigerated Air Conditioning, where he explains taking the analogy of a car which is moving on a highway. On a highway, a car goes probably 60, 70, 80 speed kilometers per hour. When it encounters a sudden 90 degree turn bend, he has to maneuver it. So the car has to firstly slow down, right? And to what extent does it have to slow down? Say about 15 kilometers per hour, big drop in the speed. Now for doing this, a great part of the energy of the fast moving car is encountered, and this has to be absorbed by the brakes. So after the turn, the car can speed up to its cruising speed, but due to the turn or bend, the car had to use more fuel, which would not have happened if there was a direct way or no bend at all. So again, if the turning on the road, if not of a sharp right angle, was a smooth curved maneuver, then he might not have to slow down as low as 15 kilometers per hour, but up to 40 to 50. So that means less fuel consumption owing to the smooth bend. The same analogy holds good here. If the air is flowing at X velocity in the duct, if it's a straight duct, no issue. The pressure drop is negligible. But if the duct suddenly takes a right turn, right angle bend, then the air has to turn and there are very substantial losses due to friction. Second one, it is hitting the dead end, so eddy current, the current returning back draft, which is also a cause of concern. So these two aspects have to be kept in mind when we are designing a good duct layout, duct size and the duct cross section. Now duct elbows are the at the turning point, the pieces that we give are called as the duct elbows. That is that one. To limit the pressure losses, elbows should be properly designed and fabricated. To avoid eddy losses at the turns, also a good well-designed elbow will help in reducing the eddy currents and the pressure loss because of the dynamic losses. So two important factors we have to take into consideration, that is radius ratio and aspect ratio. These two calculations will help us in deducing the right duct cross section and duct elbow design. So let us look at what is radius ratio and what is aspect ratio. So radius ratio RR is radius R divided by the width W. R by W gives the radius ratio. Aspect ratio AR is D by W. So these two form very important aspects for calculating the duct elbow configuration. So radius ratio 1.5 is considered to be a standard elbow and preferred most times for better efficiency. Aspect ratio exceeds 3, then there will be increased turbulence within the elbow. So these two are like thumb rules or norms that we can keep in mind when we are designing the elbow. Keep the RR 1.5 approximately and do not exceed 3 with respect to the aspect ratio. Now these are some of the examples for 90 degree bends when a duct changes its direction. The first one, sharp angle 90 degree, it is going to encounter a backdraft and eddy current at the corners, right? Second one, rounded outer corner, a little bit of smooth movement of air, but eddies cannot be prevented. Third one, smooth rounded corners, suitable. Long radius bend, still suitable because the velocity need not substantially reduce, and does not impact the pressure greatly. Then fifth one, what if we added a few directional splitters or turning vanes in the 90 degree? Say we are not able to provide a long radius bend or curved corners because of space restraint, and 90 degree bend is inevitable. So in such cases, what we do is we give splitters or turning vanes installed in sharp angle bends. These turning vanes are installed like example of a metro station, where you are going from the station, concourse, to the outside of the station. You will pass through those barriers. So it is similar way, telling the air to pass through them in the right direction without hitting the walls and creating eddy currents. So we can use splitters as a good solution for right angle bends. You can also use splitters in rounded corners still to enhance the efficiency. So these are the ways in which we can make 90 degree bend in the duct changing its direction. And the left side ones involve more pressure drops, while right side we have addressed the same. So this is an illustration of a turning vane. We can change the direction as required, manipulated. And the turning vanes ensure uniformity of airflow, greatly reducing the turbulence, results in low pressure drops, which is what is our objective. The thing is this. But lack of turning vane may cause excessive turbulence in fitting, resulting in very high pressure drops. Now, aspect ratio is an important factor to design ducts. Ratio of long side to the small side. As AR, the aspect ratio, increases, more metal surface is required for the duct for the same cross-section area. Higher aspect ratio not only increases the initial cost and the operating cost by way of increased heat gain or loss. Ideally, we should not exceed 4:1 for the aspect ratio. Maximum 4:4 is the longer side, 1 is the smaller side. Now, coming to shortlisting the characteristics of ducts which make it suitable. The duct routing should be as direct as possible for limiting the length of the duct and to minimize the frictional losses. So, two reasons on why we should adopt a direct route from the AHU to the space or space to the AHU. One is we can limit the length of the duct, so that reduces the costing substantially, and to minimize the frictional losses, it is better to keep as straight and as short as possible. Air velocity in the duct to be kept reasonably low to minimize frictional losses and noise levels. So you increase the velocity, the air turbulence increases. That will definitely increase the frictional loss and the noise levels also, vibrations, noise. So it is better to calibrate towards the lower end, but with giving right efficiency output at the terminal end. Use long radius smooth bends for changing the directions to create smooth flow. In case of sharp right angle turns, if that is inevitable because of space restraint or such reasons, provide turning vanes within the duct. It will ease the flow of air and the direction also. Galvanized iron or aluminum sheet metal should be used for fabrication of ducts to get smooth finish. Smooth finish is another essential aspect for a duct finish. Then the air's flow is also smoother. If coarse or there are projections, it will hamper the airflow. Even a minimal percentage of it will lead to reduced velocity and reduced pressure. Further, aspect ratio in rectangular ducts should be kept within 4:1. higher aspect ratio can create turbulence. You are creating like a very narrow duct, and possibly it is not suitable for the smooth movement of the air. To the right side, referring to the right side image, use properly fabricated transformation pieces for contraction and expansion in duct sizes. So these funnel kind of rectangle things, triangular things that you're seeing are the, see here, they are the transformation pieces. Why do we use them? When the duct sizes abruptly increase or reduce. So we cannot use a same main duct diameter or size for the entire ducting layout. No. It will be reduced when it end, when it reaches a room, when it is not expected that so much volume of air is needed. So main duct, tertiary duct, branching ducts, different sizes. So when it changes from that size to a smaller one or smaller to bigger, we need to have proper transformation pieces. Now why that helps, this image will let us know about it. See, this is a large duct, it has to become a small one, abrupt contraction. So severe eddy losses are encountered and leading to pressure losses with abrupt reducing the fittings. Second one, abrupt expansion, also see stagnation corners and eddy losses. So we can avoid this if we funnelize the air in a smooth manner. So put in a calibrated length of transformation piece with a good angle, aiding the smooth contraction or smooth expansion of the duct. So deciding the right length of transformation piece and the angle is also essentially done by the engineer. So this is how you can reduce abrupt changing sizes and the related eddy currents leading to pressure loss. There are three methods that are adopted for duct design: equal friction method, velocity reduction method, and static regain method. We will see these briefly. So we will see the three methods briefly ahead. Equal friction method. The friction loss per unit length of the duct is kept constant throughout the system. So that is the principle used in an equal friction method. We will try to minimize, or the friction loss per unit length of the duct is kept constant so that it is similar performance across the entire section of the stretch of the duct. For this, there are readily available air friction charts in place, and we choose the appropriate friction values from the chart. They are available, we can even check them out on the Google at different sources. ASHRAE also has it. Main duct and branch duct sizes are arrived at thereupon. So once you deduce the friction loss per unit that we want to adopt, and based on the chart, we will decide on the right sizes for the main duct and the branch duct sizes. And then we also have to cross-check this with the space available for us to provide that particular size of the duct in the plenum space. We have to correlate to the first point that we had seen. So this is a table suggested velocities in low velocity air conditioning systems, that is normally comfort ACs. So Edward Pitta has displayed this particular table in his book, where we have the intent or the object or designation at the left side, what would be for the main duct, branch risers, etc. And if it were three typologies of buildings are discussed here: residences, schools, theaters, public buildings, which basically see gathering to some different extents, industrial buildings. And the values are given in the table. These velocities are for total face area, not the net free area. Other velocities are for net free area. So it is reprinted from ASHRAE books book or handbook. So please go to ASHRAE website and take a look at the suggested standards or values in the under the different headings. They are an outcome of a good amount of research or case studies that are already done, and then the values arrived at. So readily available. Static regain method. In this, the principle is to size the duct such that the increase in static pressure due to the static gain at each branch or terminal offsets the pressure loss in the succeeding sections of the duct. So the principle is clear. You size the duct in such a manner that the increase in static pressure, at each branch or even the terminal offsets the pressure loss in the succeeding section of the duct. So we are a little being envisioning that ahead we will reduce the pressure loss in the succeeding section of the duct. Thus, static pressure at each terminal would be the same. So that we are maintaining at a constant. They are used in high velocity systems with long duct runs. So long duct runs are designed in buildings which are with larger floor plate area, big quantum of built-up space. So mostly larger industries, factories where the duct run is longer than the domestic buildings or smaller scaled buildings. Initial velocity in main duct range would be around 2500 to 4000 feet per minute. Velocity reduction method. The size of the main duct is decided from the recommended range. So again, ready tables are available for the various ranges that are recommended as a size for the main duct for different types of air distribution systems and typology of the building. Then the branch sizes are decided arbitrarily. So we pick what could be suitable. Pressure loss is computed and elbows are sized or resized. Simple method, but normally does not take into account the relative pressure losses in various branches. So that's a limitation of this method. Hence, what is done is dampers at each branch takeoff are provided to control the amount of air that will flow into the next section, the dampers. So that will control the pressure and velocity. When we control the quantum of the air, volume of the air that is going to the next, it will readily or likewise change or impact the pressure and the velocity. So this is the concept for velocity reduction method for designing, arriving at duct sizes. Now there are few websites which propose software programs to calculate the duct pressure drops and sizes. I have sourced some of them from Edward Peters' book itself, and check them out. We can readily look at them and adopt them. EliteSoft.com, RightSoft.com, Carrier.com, Train.com. These are the air conditioning providers. CarmelSoft.com. So software soft. So we can look at them and you enter the values. It will calibrate or propose the duct pressure drops and likewise leading to the sizes of the duct. So kindly check them out as an exercise hereafter. So, as a conclusion to this two sessions on ducting design, let us make a quick exercise. Undertake a market survey on the various supply and return air outlets corresponding to specific architectural requirement. So the end points of ADS would be the supply and return air grills or diffusers, as we call them. You can take a look at the various possibilities in market and what are the features that as an architect would impact your design of the false ceiling or the ambience of the space. Deduce, this is second one, is a little elaborate exercise, but good to do. You might have done it as your academic project also. Deduce a good an efficient air conditioning duct layout for your architectural design projects. So for that, firstly, you might have to decide on the equipment of AC, your choice for the air conditioning, unitary or central, where the unit is placed, and then the ducting layout for your architectural design project. Choose the current AD project itself. It's much latest and fresh, and you can incorporate that and propose a schematic duct layout as an exercise. Please do it. It will enhance your theoretical understanding that is done so far, and we actually are trying it out practically on a given design. It will enhance our understanding and reinforce the learnings. So I hope all of you take ahead this quick exercises, the market survey and the proposing a duct layout. So that ends lecture number 10 on ducting and ADS. Lecture number 11 ahead, we'll talk about air conditioning, air filtration systems, which is also a very critical element in a air conditioning system, because after all, we are giving, providing objective of providing clean air, safe, clean air, hygienic air. So ahead, let us meet with that section. Until then, see you. Take care.